people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. In another major medical feat, Indian vaccine maker Serum Institute of India has developed the country's first cervical cancer shot, which will be available in the market soon. Living up to its reputation of the pharmacy of the world, India has been consistently endeavoring to serve the humanity. After AIDS and COVID-19, Indian vaccine for cancer will be affordable and accessible to countries world over in just a few weeks from now.
The Serum Institute of India, the world's biggest vaccine maker, has developed the country's first cervical cancer shot that will hit the market soon. According to the World Health Organization, cervical cancer is the fourth most common cancer among women globally, with an estimated 604,000 new cases and 342,000 deaths in 2020. About 90% of the new cases and deaths worldwide occurred in low and middle income countries that year. Two human papilloma virus type 16 and 18 are responsible for at least 70% of cervical cancers, and India's Department of Biotechnology said the Indian vaccine would work on HPV types 16 and 18 as well as 6 and 11. Merck & Co. and GSK PLC are the main makers of HPV vaccines.
दस साल के लिए हमने प्रयास किए ये वैक्सीन बनाए कोलैबोरेशन में डीबीटी और ये मिनिस्ट्री के साथ और पहले हम हमारे देश को देंगे जैसे कि कोविड के टाइम में भी हुआ था और उसके बाद हम पूरी दुनिया को ये वैक्सीन देंगे क्योंकि दुनिया के महिलाओं के लिए ये वैक्सीन बनाई है और ये बहुत ज़रूरी है क्योंकि महिलाओं को काम करना है हेल्दी रहना है और उनके सुरक्षा के लिए ये बहुत ही ज़रूरी है.
Hailed as the pharmacy of the world, the booming pharmaceutical industry of India is a leading source of path-breaking innovation, especially when it comes to providing life-saving medicines at affordable prices to countries that need them the most. Even during the COVID-19 pandemic, the world continued to depend on Indian vaccine and pharmaceutical manufacturers to get their supply of medications. With low-cost skilled manpower and well-established manufacturing base, India is all set to play even a bigger role in worldwide drug security and continue to be one of the most favored pharmaceutical markets in the world.
शायद 200 और 400 रुपये के बीच हो सकती है, but ये सब finalize हम बाद में करेंगे government of India के साथ discuss करने के बाद. और यू नो जब हमारा मैन्युफैक्चरिंग शुरू होगा तब हम उसके दौर पे बात कर सकते हैं.
Over the past few years, India has emerged as a global medical superpower by strengthening its research and development ecosystem and fueling pharmaceuticals exports. The Indian pharmaceutical sector has firmly moved on to a path of growth and innovation, even when the entire world was gripped in the clutches of the pandemic. All that can be said with absolute confidence is that further investments will enable India's pharmaceutical sector to make it to the global top strata.
Moving on, political situation in Pakistan has been declining by the day. From terrorism charges being labeled against former Prime Minister Imran Khan to bipolar suggesting a different mood of the nation, the Pakistan politics is seemingly heading towards chaos. It has also come as double whammy as the country is already in the grip of a deep economic crisis and has been asking for funds from IMF, the global money lender, and other friendly countries.
Over the past few months, Pakistan has experienced increasing political uncertainty. And the recent terrorism charges against the country's former Prime Minister, Imran Khan, has put the Islamic Republic on edge. The ousted Prime Minister, who was charged with threatening police officers and a judge, is now facing legal proceedings in anti-terrorism court. Khan's supporters opine that the real motivation behind these charges against their leader at this juncture is to disqualify him from contesting future elections. They believe there are many reasons to substantiate their view. Khan's party has recently registered victories in local elections in the financial capital, Karachi, and the most populous province of Punjab, which is often seen as a litmus test for the national mood. Furthermore, the kind of charges Imran Khan is facing are similar to those faced earlier by the former Prime Minister, Nawaz Sharif, who is now living in London. Many analysts believe, however, that the charges Imran Khan is facing will not deter his supporters, and instead, they could raise his popularity among the masses and lead to more disruptive demonstrations.
The fact that he has been removed from power has actually added to his aura. And any action which is taken by the present dispensation against him, whether justified or not, will be used by Imran Khan and his political party to further his interest.
Pakistan has long been on the edge of tumult and financial ruin. The current crisis has brought the country's politics to a near standstill, and any further escalation could tip Pakistan into crisis. Interestingly, the Pakistani army itself is divided on political lines, and for the first time, it has come under severe public criticism over meddling into politics of the country. The army is not willing to let go of its hold over the state, while cricketer-turned-politician Imran Khan is garnering support against the political adventurism of Rawalpindi. The tug of war in Pakistan's domestic politics could undoubtedly lead to the ultimate victory for the radical forces who have their own vested interests.
As far as the TTP is concerned, they are also now aligned with the Afghanistan government, which creates a different set of problems for the Pakistan government. So as and when there is instability in Pakistan, the TTP rises.
Imran Khan initially came onto the political scene in the country with the army's backing to counter the growing strength of former leader Nawaz Sharif, who had crossed the red line of challenging the Pakistani deep state, comprising of elements from its army and its intelligence agency, ISI. Today, Shahbaz Sharif's government in Pakistan is being backed by this deep state, and Imran Khan is challenging the authority of the establishment. To advance their own interests, the so-called leaders in Pakistan have created a circus, putting the nation's future at risk. And it is the common Pakistani people who are suffering and bearing the brunt of the nation's political unrest.
Moving on. Weeks of negotiations have culminated into the International Monetary Fund agreeing to clear a loan worth $2.9 billion for the island nation Sri Lanka. The agreement is subject to approval by IMF management and its executive board and is contingent on Sri Lankan authorities following through with previously agreed measures. Meanwhile, people in the country continue to reel under an economic situation that has pushed them towards poverty. They are finding it hard to make their ends meet and are desperately looking for avenues of help.
Sri Lanka has reached a preliminary agreement with the International Monetary Fund for a loan of about $2.9 billion as the country seeks a way out its worst economic crisis in decades. The agreement is subject to approval by IMF management and its executive board and is contingent on Sri Lankan authorities following through with previously agreed measures. IMF conditions for the loan also include receiving financial assurances from Sri Lanka's official creditors and efforts by the country to reach an agreement with private creditors. Its program, spread over 4 years, will aim to boost government revenue, encourage fiscal consolidation, introduce new pricing for fuel and electricity, hike social spending, bolster central bank autonomy, and rebuild depleted foreign reserves. Once the IMF package is approved, Sri Lanka is also likely to receive further financial support from other multilateral creditors.
The objective of this fund-supported economic program is to restore macroeconomic stability and debt sustainability, while at the same time protecting the vulnerable, safeguarding financial stability, and stepping up structural reforms to address corruption vulnerabilities and unlock Sri Lanka's growth potential in the time ahead.
Sri Lanka's current financial turmoil, its worst since the country's independence from Britain in 1948, stems from economic mismanagement as well as the COVID-19 pandemic that has wiped out the country's key tourism industry. Sri Lankans have faced acute shortages of fuel and other basic goods for months, stoking unprecedented protests that forced a change in government. Ranil Wickremasinghe, a veteran lawmaker who took over as president in July, has faced an uphill battle to stabilize the economy, which has been buffeted by runaway inflation that is now at almost 65% year on year.
This is an important step in the history of our country. It's the first time that we've declared bankruptcy. And this is a key not only to resolving the immediate issues of rising from the bankruptcy crisis and the debt moratorium, but is also a key to ensure that in the medium term, our social sectors are protected, and both the economic and our social, both the economic and the social aspect of our lifestyle will certainly not have any further setbacks. So this is what we are committed to.
Meanwhile, millions of residents continue to struggle to feed their families, and there seems to be no light at the end of the tunnel for most Sri Lankans. The UN says more than a quarter of the country's 22 million people are now struggling to secure adequate, nutritious food. The crisis has left people unable to even afford a square meal and basic study material for their children. They can now only rely on the charity of employers for money to buy them. Hunger and poverty is spiraling across the country, and desperation is seeping in. And in such circumstances, one can only hope and ask the situation improves in coming days.
Time now for Asia This Week, the stories from across the continent.
South Korea and the United States have vowed to step up joint military training to deter North Korea, but for residents outside the Rodriguez Live Fire Complex and other training grounds, that means more noise and possibly security fears. The complex north of Seoul, less than 30 kilometers from the heavily fortified border with North Korea, is one of the largest training ranges for the Allies. Windows rattled as the Allies staged one of their longest live fire trainings in years, with howitzers and tanks blasting the hillsides in a simulated counterattack against a hypothetical northern onslaught. Loud and sometimes dangerous military training has long been a fact of life in one of the world's geopolitical hotspots, but in an increasingly wealthy and crowded South Korea, some residents' patience has worn thin. People's gardens can be seen decorated with spent artillery shells and machine gun casings that fell outside the training range decades ago. US military officers have said the military was looking into the concerns, noting that they paused for a period to allow quiet testing at schools. Of particular concern were the Apache attack helicopters, which had been banned from firing at the Pochon range since 2019 over the complaints. Germany and Israel reached a compensation agreement this week, 50 years after 11 Israeli athletes were killed during a botched rescue attempt following their kidnapping by Palestinian gunmen at the Munich Olympics. The deal could put an end to a row which has lasted for years between the victims' relatives and German authorities. According to a statement released by the German and Israeli president said, the German state acknowledges its responsibility and recognizes the terrible suffering of the murdered athletes and their families. Last month, the family said they were unhappy with the latest German compensation offers and that they plan to boycott a ceremony marking the 50th anniversary of the attack in protest. On September 5, 1972, members of the Israeli Olympic team were taken hostage at the poorly secured athletes' village by Palestinian gunmen from the Black September group. Within 24 hours, 11 Israelis, 5 Palestinians and a German policeman were dead after a standoff and subsequent rescue effort erupted into gunfire. Japanese Railways will mark its 150th anniversary in October this year. Ever since the inception of railways in Japan, the economy of the country developed to a great extent. Japanese Railways started with a steam-powered locomotive that ran between Shinbashi in Tokyo and Yokohama. Now railways are being run by electrically powered engines, which are now spread across the length and breadth of Japan. An exhibition of railway models was organized with the theme of the 150th anniversary of functioning of Japanese railways. A scaled-down model of an old railway runs through a small diorama.
150年ということで、テーマ付けされておりまして、その頃の時代を写真でこちらの方に展示させていただいておりまして、年表も作りまして、その変遷をお客様にアピールして、馴染んでいただきたいということでやっております。鉄道模型はキングスオブホビーという形で、家の中に線路を引いて、自分一人でも楽しめる、モデラーの方が集まって、みんなで楽しむと、同じ線路を共有して、車両を持ち込んで楽しむと。
A reproduction model of the railway starting from Tokyo expresses the unique scenery of the Japanese capital. Train is running in traffic congestion. The most important container freight train for distribution is the longest train in Japan. In Japan, it runs through an old brick tunnel and an iron bridge. This is rich and beautiful view of Japan. The model of trains, which is created by enthusiasts and modelers, has revived the charm of yesteryear railways that had once disappeared. It portrays 150 years history of Japanese railways, which is being handed down to the future generations. Sushi and sashimi, which are important Japanese dishes, have now become popular all around the world. Japan is surrounded by sea on all sides, which has made seafood and seaweed staple ingredients. Because of the seafood culture being extremely popular in Japan, marketing and manufacturing of processed marine products along with the entire fishery industry has developed in Japan. Crab is amongst the most popular seafood ingredients in Japan, which is enjoyed by most of the tourists and locals in Japan. For this, preservation and processing of crab meat to keep the crabs fresh becomes necessary.
まあ、世界からカニを輸入して、日本で、加工して日本で売るっていう仕事をやってますね。特に年末にかけて売れる、売上金額って見てると、やっぱカニが一番多いですね。今年はカニの値段が下がってきたんで、 面白いと思います。
The raft of fish farming has solar panel and camera. By using this application, fishermen can check image of the fishing ground, data such as tide level and oxygen concentration to help their business. Marine Ecolabel aims to protect the environment of marine resources from various angles. It follows FAO guidelines and acts as an international standard scheme. The various methods of fishing farming. The products of the certified company are labeled. Japan's fishery industry is changing by its global awareness of the environment, communication and digital technology utilizing IoT.
Moving on. Ganesh Chaturthi, one of India's most well-known and auspicious celebrations, is the ideal fusion of vitality, culture and history. It is a highly anticipated holiday celebrated in honor of Lord Ganesha, the Hindu god of wisdom, and is especially popular in the south and west of the nation. See how Indians are celebrating Ganesh Chaturthi this year with pious zeal and artistic flair.
Hundreds of thousands of devotees across India thronged temples to celebrate the birth anniversary of the Hindu elephant god Ganesh as they offered prayers to the deity of prosperity. Ganesh Chaturthi or Vinayaka Chaturthi is celebrated in honor of Lord Ganesh, who is considered the deity of prosperity by Hindus. The festival is majorly celebrated in the western and southern parts of the country.
मैंने भगवान से यही करी कि जो भी दो साल से हुआ है अब नहीं होना चाहिए और गणपति महाराज का आज शुभ दिन है बहुत अच्छा लग रहा है बहुत खुशी हो रही है और जब जब मतलब दो साल से बंद था तो ऐसा लगता था कि कब ये बीमारी चले जाए और हमारे गणेश जी की हमको पूजा करने के लिए मिले करके
The western Mumbai city saw a sea of devotees offering prayers to an idol of Lord Ganesha as the priest performed rituals and aarti at the Siddhi Vinayak Mandir. Worshippers prayed to Lal Bagh Saraja, which is a large Ganesh idol at Lal Bagh in Mumbai. People here can also place an online order for prasad. Police personnel welcomed Police Bappa at Vilepale Police Station in the city. Wearing a khaki uniform, the Police Bappa holds a mobile phone in his hand. The purpose behind bringing Police Bappa is to create awareness about cyber fraud. Meanwhile, in Guwahati city of Assam, Ganesh Chaturthi was observed with much grandeur. As a part of the festival, a procession was organized in which a priest carried an idol of Lord Ganesha and all other people followed him.
देखो 5:30 बजे आया हूँ एक्चुअली बहुत लाइन है लंबा लाइन है फिर भी बहुत पीसफुली मतलब सक्सेसफुल हुआ है मतलब बहुत अच्छा लगा सब लोग इतना मतलब अच्छे तरह से पूजा करने के लिए आए
In Guwahati, women also took part in the procession with great enthusiasm. They were seen walking with earthen pots on their heads. Devotees were seen waiting in queues to offer their prayers to Lord Ganesha.
While Lord Ganesha's festival didn't used to gather this traction and festivity in all parts of the country, its popularity has grown exponentially in the past few years. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.